Then if you know anyone who knows about global justice now, it's a kind of an organisation that's been set up to campaign to change the economic political structures that cause poverty throughout the world, but particularly in the global south. And it has activist groups in all over the country, and myself and a few of the people in the audience here are part of the Central London group, and we meet once a month on the second Monday, second Monday of the month in Central London at 7 o'clock. And if anyone wants to is interested in coming along, we've got a stall at the back, and we'll give you some more details at the end of the meeting. So, just for a few housekeepings, there's some toilets. If anyone needs a toilet, there's toilets down the corridor on the right-hand side. And if there's a fire alarm goes off, there's no fire drills for today. So if there's a fire alarm goes off, we can go and meet John, who's the guy in reception, and he'll tell us where to go, which is outside of the hospital, round by St Pancras Churchyard. Okay, but without further ado, I'll start. So we've got three speakers who are going to hopefully help us examine some of the ideas around austerity and about kind of what's happened in the past, particularly in the global south, and also obviously what's happening in Greece and what's happening now in the UK. So I think first of all, Nick's going to speak to us about the past and what happened in the 80s and 90s. Nick's the director of Global Justice now. He joined the organisation in September 2013. He started his career at War on Month, where he became a senior campaigner. He went on to the Corpus Campaign Manager at Amnesty International, was director of the Jubilee, and then as director of the Jubilee campaign. He built strong relationships with campaigners in the global south and helped to win new laws to stop vulture funds from using UK courts to squeeze huge debt. So, Nick?
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, I want to give a bit of background to what's going on in Greece, and for some of you the story will be familiar, and for others it may be new, but I hope it's interesting for everybody. I don't know if people saw, it's about 3 years ago now, the Red Cross issued a report on the state of Europe, and it was a pretty startling report, because the Red Cross is not known for its over-the-top political pronouncements. It tries to be a very non-political organisation. And it characterised, the picture it painted characterised the Europe today as one of immense inequality, deep pockets of poverty, racism, violence, people feeling alienated and disempowered. And the report said, it's really incredible that this has happened in the centre of one of the richest parts of the world. And I think that people don't, you know, we think people haven't quite understood what exactly has happened to us, how deep the crisis has been, and how we've got here. And it said, you know, the most shocking thing is how the poorest in our society have borne the heaviest price for a crisis they did nothing to create. And from the Red Cross, that's quite a statement, quite an astonishing statement. So what I want to do is try and explore a little bit how we did get here, from my perspective. And then hopefully we can hear more about concretely what's happening in Greece as the worst crisis hit bit of Europe at the moment. And maybe what hope we can see there as well. We have a global economy which I would say today is characterized by inequality. I mean, you know, there's the shocking Oxfam statistics you've probably seen. 80 people in the world have the same amount of wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people. You know, it was interesting, actually, there was a report done by Forbes magazine that a lot of the American elite read. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's a very good magazine. And they said, this is a shocking figure. We're not sure we believe it. So they looked into it and they said, well, actually, it was true, but it's not true anymore. Because in the 6 months since this statistic has been researched by Oxfam, it's changed, and it's now only 67 richest people in the world. And then at the end, they put a little thing on saying, well, since this article was written, it's changed again, and it's now 66 people, 66 richest people. And that was about 12 months ago, so it's probably changed again by now. But searing inequality, and for those at the bottom, volatility and crisis. Since the mid-70s, we have a global economy characterized by crisis. So I want to rewind a little bit back to the mid-1970s, when we had an economy that wasn't characterized by so much inequality. wasn't characterized by so much volatility and crisis, and see what happened. And it really began through an economic crisis, a crisis of overspending in the United States, and a crisis for especially the banks and the financial sector of profitability. They were in a real crisis that they couldn't maintain their profit levels. And there'd been enormous American overspending through the Vietnam War. And the elites of America were, you know, how do we deal with this? How do we maintain the structure of society? And they took some really very radical steps that weren't really seen at the time for being as radical as they were. And one of them was to say we need to deregulate the monetary system, essentially. Up until then, exchange rates had been fixed next to one another, and currencies had been, you know, worth something in relation to one another and in relation to gold. When Nixon was president in America, he said, "I'm sorry, it's just not worth that anymore, and that's your problem. You all need the dollar. The dollar is the world currency." So he de-linked the dollar from gold, and it floated. And the French even sent their boats to New York to pick up all the gold that they owed, and it's just like, no, too bad. And that was really a very, very important decision, because what that led to was a complete deregulation of finance and of lending and all the things that have become so common to us today. And in particular, it led to a massive lending spurge on the part of the banks, American banks, Japanese banks, and European banks, to developing world countries, what we call third world countries at the time. And they weren't really that bothered about who they were lending to, whether it was a particularly pleasant regime or what those regimes were borrowing money for, whether it was palaces in the middle of the jungle or weapons or whatever it may be. They just lent huge amounts of money, expecting to get it back because a country can't go bankrupt. So it's a safe option. They weren't making huge amounts of interest on it, but it seemed pretty safe. And then, at the end of the 70s, there was another shock, and the American elites were really worried again, this time by stagflation, what they call stagflation, raising unemployment and raising inflation at the same time. And inflation, of course, wiping out their profits. How do we get inflation under control? We raise interest rates. And they rose interest rates knowing this would create a crisis for the huge amounts of money that had been lent out to developing countries, and indeed it did. And in 1982, Mexico essentially went bankrupt. Said we can't pay, and the financial markets were in turmoil. Well, if Mexico doesn't pay, then next week Argentina won't pay, and Brazil won't pay, and the whole financial system's on the verge of collapse. What do? We better lend them the money. And this is where the International Monetary Fund, our friends the International Monetary Fund, stepped in, lent them money so that they could repay yesterday's debts. But of course, the actual debt just kept growing and growing and growing and growing, because it was completely unsustainable, just as we see in Greece and parts of Europe today. And it wasn't just that there were very unsustainable debts that could never be repaid. Also, that lending came with conditions. And those conditions were called structural adjustment policies at the time, but essentially they are the basis of the global economy we have today, the conditions that were imposed on developing countries at that time. And they consisted of cuts, massive austerity, massive spending cuts. So countries that were starting to build up an education sector and a health sector can't do that anymore because your priority is paying the debt. Secondly, gear your economy up to export, because if you export stuff, you will be able to earn the hard currency, the dollars, the pounds, the francs, in order to repay these debts, which are denominated in those currencies. Your local currency is worthless. We don't want that. We want hard currency, so export stuff. Liberalize your trade system, liberalize your financial system, so money can more easily go in and out of your economy. That would be great, because it will mean people will come and invest more easily, and you'll earn more money, and you can repay the debts with that money. And privatize everything, because you can't afford all of these state assets anymore. So hand them over to the private sector, you'll earn money, and you can repay the debt. Well, of course, this had no effect, really, on the debt burden. The debt burden kept going up because the debts were completely unsustainable. But what it did was massively transform the nature of those economies. It led to hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people dying, being thrown out of work, not receiving the medicines they were owed. It's a human tragedy of monumental proportions, even though it's not a story that's particularly well known. It's not taught to us in school or anything. Happened in most of our lifetimes. and created this economy whereby for the poorest in society, they had no safety net. The food that was grown in their country was grown for other people across the world rather than for them. They could have no control over their financial system, over money going in and out, so speculative money came into their countries all the time. Sure, foreign businesses invested, but just as quickly they could withdraw their profits and send them back home somewhere safer. And of course they had no basis to build up any kind of industry or agricultural base because they privatized everything. So the state of the developing world today still bears the scars of that period of structural adjustment. And so I think it's important to look back on it because it's exactly what's happening in many parts of Europe today. And as countries got more and more and more unequal, which they did, and as pockets of poverty got worse and worse, of course that just made the need for debt even greater. How do you keep the economy going when the vast number of people in your economy can't afford anything anymore? Well, debt, more financial liberalisation, more power to the bank, more innovative ways of lending money. What we're seeing in Europe today is a similar situation. The banks that lent the money through reckless lending have been bailed out. They've got their money back, just as all of our high street banks did in the third world debt crisis. You know, the banks involved were NatWest and Midlands Bank at the time and so on. They got their money back and it became a public debt. And that's exactly what happened in the majority of European countries today. So the majority of southern European countries and Ireland as well, and our country as well, the majority of our debt has simply been shifted from a private debt to a public debt. And the financial system goes on, operating as it did before, and the poorest in our society pay the price. And that is making already inequality worse. So since the financial crash, of the growth that's happened in the United States of America, 95% of that, which is virtually all of it, has gone to the 1%. The 1% is still benefiting massively from all the growth that's happened. We have a massively unequal economy still. So in the minute I have left, what on earth do we do about this situation? Well, hopefully Marina's going to give some indication in terms of Greece and practical solidarity. But essentially, I think we need to definancialize our economy. The campaigns that people are waging in this country to keep hold of our National Health Service, to not let things be privatized, the anti-austerity movement here is a vital component of that, because we have no basis otherwise to be able to fight against it. And I would say, because it can seem really doom and gloom and quite depressing, obviously, but I would say I can see hope at the moment all over Europe. In the same way that I could see hope 15 years ago in Latin America, where none of us thought it was there. I remember being at university and learning about Latin America, and an absolutely awful lecturer who used to dine out with the elites of Latin America, and his lectures would be a series of anecdotes about these technocratic governments, they called them at the time, that had come in, there'd been a wave of dictators and torture and killings, they'd been overthrown by people rising up and saying no more, and then as those dictators had been overthrown, as democratic governments came to power, the IMF came in and said, but hang on, you owe us that debt. So you have no control over your economic policy, you will do as you're told. And technocratic governments came in to carry out those policies. And I thought, that sounds like an awful part of the world. I can't see what possibly is going to come that's positive from that part of the world. And of course, within a few years, it was the biggest challenge that this economic model has ever had, as governments came to power on the back of movements fighting against water privatisation and all the rest of it. I can begin to see now some similar things going on in Europe today, from the solidarity kitchens, health sector, the solidarity education that's going on in Greece, people saying we refuse to descend into barbarism. We actually return to the idea that there is such a thing as community, there is such a thing as society. And although it's very fragile, very difficult, and people are exhausted, people are beginning to refine the bonds that hold us together. And out of that, I think, can begin to come something really different. And we already see it with, despite everything that's happened, and despite the disappointments and setbacks, political parties that are quite different from parties we've seen in the past, doing better, coming to power on a very, very different narrative, a very different story than has been rammed down our throats for the last 40 years. And through that, I think we can begin to get a grasp of what's possible. And I haven't got time to go into it anymore, but maybe we can come back to it in some of the questions. Thank you.
same limits. Have a little look at Greece and what's been happening in Greece. Marina is a senior lecturer in media and politics at University of East Anglia. She joined in 2009. Before that, she's lectured at a number of universities in this country, including City University, Open University, and the University of Middlesex. But for us, what's important is that she's the London representative for Syriza.
We don't have representatives, but I've been talking about Syriza quite a lot. So shall I start? Yeah, we don't have representatives. We have a Syriza London branch, which some of us said a few years ago, and I have been talking a lot about the situation in Greece and Syriza. But I don't want to focus necessarily on Syriza, but talk a little bit about the situation that Nick was describing. And the problem with these structural adjustments that Nick was talking about is that they are still the orthodoxy. So the IMF and the World Bank, they still insist that this is the way forward. And in many cases, we have seen in countries in Africa or Latin America that they have rejected them, that they didn't work, that they created huge inequality. Still, they go on with these ideas. And there is a reason why they go on with these ideas. It's because it's not only about economics, and definitely the way they understand economics is not a good society for as many people as possible. It's about politics. It's about imposing neoliberalism as the dominant order, getting rid of all left governments, and imposing this particular economic system that is going only to give gains to very, very few people. So it is politics, it's not only economics. In a way, what I want to stress here is that we have to depoliticize economy. For many years, we are thinking economy is it's something there that is happening, and we don't really understand it, and we have these economies that they come on the media and they tell us how economy, this order that is beyond our control, is operating. And that is something we have to change. There are different options. They have taken a very particular one, which, as Nick was saying, it has to do with trade liberalization, price deregulation, privatization. Now, when this system was imposed in the 80s and 90s in different countries, back then they were talking about the developing countries. And now, with Greece, we have the same situation, but now they cannot talk about a developing country that it has been outside this particular economic system. It has been part of that. Greece is part of Europe. And still, the measures they are trying to impose are exactly the same. So again, it's not about economics, it's about politics. And the neoliberal order has one and only one solution that fits all. It doesn't matter if we're talking Africa, it doesn't matter if we talk South America, it doesn't matter if we talk about Greece. Privatize everything, deregulate the labor market, make everybody have no rights whatsoever, employment rights, all these rights that we've been fighting for all these years, and this will make things work better. They won't work better, they will work very bad for us, and we have seen that in the case of Greece. So as Nick was saying, when the crisis started, Greece had 120% debt in relation to the GDP. And now it has been to 180%, so it is increasing rather than going down. And if the latest adjustments that they have asked us to implement go ahead, which they are going right now, probably in a couple of years it will be about 200% of the GDP. So what we know is that they have not worked. Austerity has not worked. These adjustments that they asked us, they are not working in relation to the debt, which that was their main justification, that if you do these privatizations, if you change the labor market, this will be better for your debt, you will be able to pay. Well, it's unsustainable. Now, I don't know if you followed the situation in Greece, but how they tried to implement these adjustments, it became clear in the latest negotiations that we had between Greece, European Union, European Committee, IMF, and European Central Bank. And it was clear that after 5 years that we had tried these austerity measures, these programs, they hadn't worked. January 15th, we have a new government, and Syriza comes to power with a radical left program, and they were very much sure that they will not allow it to go ahead. It is a political decision. In their recipe, left governments are always seen as a cause for destabilization, and they do say so in their reports. Any left government is going to be seen as dangerous. And they will try to bring it down, and I think that's exactly what they tried to do with Syriza, which had to accept at the end the packages, the austerity packages. So 25th, Syriza comes to power of January, the negotiations start, they go on, and in all this time that the negotiations go on, the main idea was to, from the side of the institutions, to try to discredit Syriza. This is what they do. This government doesn't know what they are supposed to do. They haven't sent us the paper. They don't understand the situation. And this was a constant fight between Greece and the institutions until 25th of June, when they gave, after months, it started in January and it was 6 months after, they gave an ultimatum to the Greek government, which is, that's the deal, you take it or leave it. Still, we were fighting back, and we didn't accept at that point the deal. And on June 30th, there were capital controls imposed on Greece. These were imposed by the government because they were afraid that a lot of money, the little bit of money that they had been left there, they will start to go out. But it was, it happened after the European Stability Mechanism refused to provide the funding that the Greek government asked for. This is against European Union legislation. The idea of the European Central Bank and the idea of the Stability Mechanism is that they provide banks, they provide banks with funding and liquidity in the benefit of the whole supposedly European system. This, of course, has nothing to do with that, and they refused to give any liquidity to Greece, which means again that we saw clearly that it was a political move to try to persuade the government to follow their own dictates. The response of the Greek government was to call a referendum. It was seen as a huge aggressive move on the part of the Greek government, where 62% of the people, they rejected the austerity measures that the institutions were imposing. And we go back to the negotiations, thinking that because the Greek people have voted that they don't want austerity, somebody will listen. Fat chance. They saw it as an aggressive move. On July 12th, the German proposal, which was followed by the institutions, it was the most hideous thing that anyone had seen, totally undemocratic. It was suggesting that the main assets of Greece should be transferred to a bank in Luxembourg, and they will be dealing with that. I mean, nobody was believing that there was such a proposal within the European Union and European Union countries, because they have done much worse, of course, in other parts of the world. But we were thinking, okay, here is Europe. They are not going effectively to impose a dictatorship. But they did. And then from there, we moved to a less, well, it's equally hideous, actually, proposal, which we accepted on July 13th. Well, the assets will not be moved to Luxembourg, but of course a lot of the state assets will be privatized. So this was how the negotiations were going. Of course, this has to do nothing with sound economics. It was an attempt to say, we are not going to allow any of these left governments or the people to dictate what they are going to do. There is only one way, our way. July 15th, and after we have signed the agreement, and all this time the three institutions, IMF, European Central Bank, and European Commission were working together. For the first time after we signed the agreement, the IMF comes out to say that the Greek debt is unsustainable. So effectively taking the peace. All this time, our position was, this is not going to work, the debt is not sustainable, we have to deal with that. The moment they have forced you to the ground to accept this, they come out and they say, you know what, this debt is unsustainable, and then you have a differentiation between IMF and European Central Bank and European Commission. Now, of course, now the situation in Greece is very difficult, and it's going to be difficult, and we have to accept that the Syriza government has been defeated. It didn't manage to implement its own program. And we hope, however, I mean, that things will start changing more generally in the European Union and the European Union members, because there is generalized austerity. And then in different conditions, probably Greece will manage to change something from this path. Who is benefiting in that? As Nick says, this is after reports of what is happening in Greece. Those that they are going to benefit is the upper classes of Greece. There is no problem there. A lot of European banks, German ones, and so on. And of course, because as I said, all this discussion is about politics. Another group that is benefiting quite a lot is the fascists. The fascists in Greece, where Golden Dawn is the third biggest party. It's a Nazi party. But we see this situation that it is happening everywhere in Europe, with Marine Le Pen, with UKIP here, and so on. So in this situation, where they try to put down any alternative from anybody else which is seen as socialist, lefty, and so on, they give more power to the right wing, which they appear like the new saviors. But still, I think we can do enough. What we have to understand is that Greece is not a place which is out there, and the solidarity we need and the support we need is not something which is going to benefit our neighbors that they're out there, but this is a situation that we are all facing together. Greece is the laboratory, the first case that they are trying to impose these measures, but the same they are trying to do here, and the same they are going to do across the Europe. So we have all of us together to work on the ground, but also on upper level to change the neoliberal governments that they are trying to impose these rules, because I think this is the only way forward. Solidarity is not an act of goodwill. Now it is for saving all of us, I think. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Marina. That was great. So that brings us nicely, obviously, thinking about saving all of us, to what's happening in austerity in this country. So Michael's going to hopefully have a talk a little about what's happening in this country. Michael Gove is a Londoner who spent most of his working life working in the travel industry. He was a member of the Labour Party in the 60s, but left disillusioned and decided to try parties new, and has spent long periods of working abroad, particularly in Holland, Greece and South America.
South Africa.
Since returning to London, he's become quite active in the Occupy movement and has a very interesting website called Radical Soapbox, and writes on politics and economics and the absurdity of austerity.
Are you back in the Labour Party, by the way?
No, Green Party.
Oh.
Thanks. Einstein defined insanity as doing the same experiment over and over again and expecting a different result. Now, the point of austerity is it is alleged to reduce debt. But austerity has not reduced debt in Greece. It's not reduced debt in Britain. Greece has had austerity plus, and that hasn't reduced debt but increased it. And now they've had austerity plus extra, which has not reduced debt but has increased it. And as Marina has pointed out, the IMF has belatedly accepted that the debt is totally unsustainable. What's happening is a conventional recession in Greece, or depression, depending where you want to, how you measure it. And Britain has been in a recession and is heading back into it now. Now, conventional Keynesian economics says that in a recession, the private sector will not invest, therefore the government has to take up the slack and put the money in. When he wrote this in the 30s, it was mainly about the states. Europe did not invest. But in America, Roosevelt was very strong on big infrastructure products such as the Tennessee Valley Authority, all the dams, etc. And so this did help bring America out of the Depression. Of course, the real thing that brought Britain and America out of the Depression was war, which took up the slack of the unemployment. At the same time as austerity, we've had quantitative easing, QE, which is another way of saying printing money. Now, quantitative easing has never been tried before. So what has been tried is the opposite, which is quantitative tightening. Now, quantitative tightening is used when an economy is overheating, and therefore the central bank asks the banks and the financial institutions to deposit more money with them. And this will stop them lending, and it will take some of the heat out of the economy. But never before has quantitative easing been tried. Now, the theory is that neoliberalism is like a fundamentalist religion. There's no point in trying to explain or discuss anything. They have a dogma and they stick to it. The dogma says the state couldn't organise a piss up in a brewery and that the private sector is wonderful. So instead of the state picking up the slack and investing to get people back to work, because what makes an economy come back and grow is people spending. Is demand. So the money of quantitative easing, the printed money, is used to buy back bonds and government paper from the private sector and give them cash. But they're not going to invest it. The banks are not lending to business. They're not lending for anything that will employ people. What they're doing is they're lending the money to hedge funds, to bet on shares, to bet on currencies, the LIBOR market, to fiddle the markets, to bet on two flies going up a wall. But it doesn't produce any demand. It doesn't employ people to give them money to spend. If we were going to use quantitative easing, we ought to use the helicopter version, the people's quantitative easing. It's called helicopter because you load a helicopter with money, you take it up in the sky, and you throw the money out for people who can then go and spend it. And this has actually been proposed by Richard Murphy of the Tax Justice Network to McDonnell and Corbyn, that what you do, which in Greece, for instance, you would have given, let's say, €3,000 to every adult. Here you might give £2,500 to every adult. Now, one of the arguments against it is that you're giving to as well to people that have money and they're going to save it and not spend it. Well, that's simple. You date it. If it's not spent within 3 months, it's worthless. Now, of course, you'll get a black market because people that don't want to spend it, they say, OK, I've got 3,000 quid here, I'll sell it for 2,000. But the money will be spent. That money will be spent and it will create demand. So what we have, and particularly with Greece and the euro, about 2.5 years ago, I put a piece on the website called Germany is Destroying the Euro. Because to me, the problem with the euro and Europe is not Greece, it's Germany. Now, not many people have ever agreed with this, but two weeks ago in Kilkenny, where David McWilliams, the Irish economist, holds his Kilkenny economic festival, a German economist, Heiner Fassbach, actually said very much the same thing, that the problem is Germany. And he went further than helicoptering. He said that what Germany should have done a few years ago was to bring in some form of Marshall aid for Greece, Ireland, Spain, Portugal and Italy. Now, for those that are too young or have never read up on Marshall aid, after the Second World War, President Truman was worried about Europe, Western Europe, and especially Germany, going communist. So he sent General Marshall over on a fact-finding mission. Marshall came back and reported, yes, they're likely to go communist, nothing to do with Russia, They're starving. The Deutschmark's worthless. The most stable currency is American cigarettes. So we have to do something. Vast amounts of money were lent, given to Germany, small amounts to France, and Britain had slightly different arrangements with getting money from the state, a lot of it on something called Lend-Lease. Germany also still had the debt from the end of the First World War, the reparations that were forced upon them and directly led to the rise of fascism and the Nazis. So in 1953, a conference was called in London over German debt. And it was agreed that a large amount of the debt would be written off. It was agreed that interest rates would be reduced, and it was agreed that the period would be extended for the repayment of the debt. And sick as it is, one of the countries that wrote off an amount of debt was Greece. Yet 50 years later, Germany cannot even think about this. And it's also interesting that Yanis Varoufakis pointed out that when Greece was occupied, the Nazis forced Greece to lend money to the Nazis, to the Germans. That money has never been repaid. And the settlement between West Germany and Greece in, I think it was 1961, was a ridiculously low amount of money. And conveniently, Varoufakis has calculated that if Germany was to repay everything it owes to Greece, it just about wipes out the current Greek debt. So when we look at the mess Greece has got into, and the similar mess that we're heading towards, right, did the banks, mainly German, but French, Dutch, Austrian, etc., who lent the money to Greece, somehow seem to think that because Greece and Ireland were now in the euro, that they were legitimate borrowers, that they could actually repay this money? What was the money spent on? Well, we know about a lot was wasted, and that is perfectly true. We know about the 2004 Olympics. But what's never mentioned is things like arms sales. The Neue Demokratie government, the conservative government that was in power, was spending 3% of GDP on defence. Now, that is the largest amount that was spent by any NATO country. At one point, the calculation is that on paper or in theory, Greece had more tanks than Britain, France and Germany added together. It's interesting, and I have to read this. Germany had four main suppliers. The tanks came from Krauss Maffei. The military vehicles came from Daimler-Benz, who are probably also fiddling the emission standards. The submarines came from Ferrostal, and the anti-aircraft guns came from Rheinmetall. Now, in 2012, the Greek defence minister of this period was sentenced to 20 years in prison for accepting bribes from the German companies. And obviously, the money to pay for these was borrowed from the German banks. Now, what happened in Germany? The companies were fined. They got their wrists wrapped. If you go to jail for 20 years for accepting a bribe, I'd have thought that 20 years was about the same for giving the bribe. And Wolfgang Schäuble, who's the German finance minister, had been one of the hardest on Greece. He certainly knew about this. And also he's very quiet about the fact that in the 1990s, he was illegally getting cash donations for the CDU, the Christian Democratic Union, which is the party of Merkel and the party of government. When I wrote the piece, Germany's Destroying the Euro, I took something that Keynes had also said, and that was if one country was in surplus, other countries were in deficit. And he had suggested, talking about the US in the 1930s, that if after a period of, say, a year, the surplus hadn't been transferred back or spent with the countries in deficit, it should be they'd given back forcibly. And this made me think that, you know, leaving aside all the things about countries being in the euro at the wrong levels, that Germany has an overvalued currency, Greece has an overvalued currency, Germany has a vastly undervalued currency and therefore is highly competitive. You know, if the German government won't give back the money to Ireland, Greece, etc. Why wouldn't the German burghers spend vast amounts of money on having holidays to Ireland, Spain, Portugal, Italy, and especially Greece? It was only meant as a throwaway thing, but suddenly this summer, around the time of the referendum and the second election, I started thinking and talking with other people, saying, well, you know, you've got all this in the press about buying Greek yogurt, tzatziki, wine, etc., and going on holiday to Greece. And I know David took a holiday in Greece for the first time on the basis that he would put a bit of money back in. And started talking about, well, couldn't we do political holidays to Greece? So that people could go down and they could, you know, spend a week going around seeing how the health centres worked, how the kitchens worked, how the education worked, meeting the people, etc. And hopefully building up some liaison contact between groups and communities in the UK and groups in Greece. And I have spoken with Nick about it and with David about it. I haven't spoken with Marina about it. But it seemed that, and I've spoken with a number of people, that there is an amount of interest in doing this because it actually gives the opportunity to see what has happened and to feel more involved. And by staying in family-owned accommodation, eating in tavernas, you're putting the money into the local economy. You're not putting it into multinational hotel groups, etc. And obviously, there could be the opportunity, if people want to stay on for an extra week and go off to an island or a couple of islands, that can be all suited, fitted in. But there is also possibly, and where I'm going to end, another reason for people here doing this. Because we haven't had Austerity Plus, or Austerity Plus Extra, and we're going to get it. Osborne has been stopped by an unelected, undemocratic House of Lords, but they intend to do this. And I think it's an absolute certainty that the NHS being free at the point of delivery is over. It's just a matter of time. And anybody that tells you the NHS is being privatised is wrong. It's being given away. If it was privatised, you'd actually get some money for it, even if it wasn't enough. But it's not. It's being given away. Currently, and just to digress and bring it back here, there are 53,000 contracts between different parts of the NHS and qualified suppliers. This employs 25,000 people and costs $1.5 billion a year out of the budget that is supposed to be available for treating patients. Now, that only represents about 10% of what is being contracted, can be contracted out. So all the NHS is going to become is a badge that private companies put on their letterheads, etc. So I think we may have to go to Greece to learn how to deal with what we've got coming in this country. And I wish I had Nick's optimism, but I don't. The only thing I'm optimistic about is that I'm old enough that I ought to miss the worst of it. So thank you very much.
Thanks very much for the three of you for the interesting talk and certainly learning some new things. There's one question I wanted to ask before I kind of open up to everyone else, and that's the person sitting here I'm going to ask it. It's really to Marina. When I speak to my friends about Greece and about kind of the problems in Greece, a lot of the people that come back with is, the Greeks, they never paid any tax. They never, you know, and that's their own fault because they never paid any tax. That's where all the debt's there. I mean, is this true? And if it's not true, kind of, how do you counter that kind of propaganda?
Well, there are different answers to that. And the truth is that it's not only happening in Greece. In countries where you don't have any faith in the political system and it's quite volatile, it's much more difficult to persuade people to pay taxes. And Greece is one of these countries. It had a dictatorship. There is always this sense of instability. But the main people who are tax evading, they are the top people. It's not the £2 that I'm going, for example, to avoid giving to the taxpayer. So again, we are talking about the same class. which these clans is not Greeks, they are international. It's the people who took their money out, a lot of which they were not paying taxes, and they bought a lot of huge flats in London when the crisis started. So we are talking about a very particular class which is evading tax in the same way that it is evading tax in Britain as well, and in many cases quite legally. So you remember the case, for example, with HSBC, when we figured out that one of the people in HSBC was a consultant in the Conservative government, and he was creating tax havens, effectively explaining to people how they can evade taxation here. So there is, of course, this class, and it is costing quite a lot of money. But the numbers that we are talking about in relation to the debt and how the debt has grown and so on, you wouldn't change this because some people will pay the tax. We're talking about huge numbers of money. There was a committee in relation to how we acquire this huge debt, the Committee on the Truth of the Public Debt, and the reasons are quite different. Some is military expenditure as well, and of course in many cases we are forced into this situation by being members of NATO and so on, and we have a huge number of a huge army, effectively, for such a small country, and we spend quite a lot of money on that. But also because the interest rates from which we were borrowing, they were huge, and they increased the debt quite a lot. So there is a whole report of how we acquired that stuff, but it's not down to the everyday people. These are the type of easy answers that a lot of the European and the British media were trying to give in order to give a particular picture of the Greek people. This is how they are lazy. And this is how one of the things that we have to do here, fight back the media, that they are given a very particular picture and stereotypical representation of Greece. Same stuff they are doing the last few days in relation to refugees, painting their masks, trying to connect them with terrorism and Islamic State anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we used to have the same thing when we talked about African debt, and the narrative was all about corruption. And of course corruption is a big issue, and it's you know, there is corruption in a lot of African governments, and it takes two to be corrupt, like you said as well. I mean, who's on the other side of the corruption? But the problem was that any government that could come to power and deal with this was not able to do so, precisely because of the structural adjustment undercutting any kind of democratic legitimacy in those societies. So I know he's not Marina's favourite person, but Yanis Varoufakis wrote a very interesting article about the negotiations, saying, look, at the beginning of the negotiations, we said we can agree on certain things. One of the things we can agree on is a fairer tax system in Greece. Let's harvest that. Let's do that now. And then we talk about the other things later on. And the European Commission said, no, absolutely not. It's a full deal about everything or it's nothing. So progress could have been made on tax under the first few months of the Syriza government that wasn't made.
And on corruption again.
And on corruption too, which is an issue, yeah.
Has anyone got any questions? Glenn, and then...
Sorry, I'm just doing video. Is everyone okay to be on the video?
Yeah.
Okay. okay, I had a question for Marina. It's just about the situation at the moment. You said when you were giving the talk that you were hoping that things might get better for people. And I just wanted to know, there was a, as we all know, there was a general strike in Greece last Friday because people are really suffering because of the austerity. And I understand that the latest tranche of the 86 billion bailout was released with conditions that to make it easier to foreclose on people's houses, for instance. And I just wanted to know what concrete steps the government can take now to make it easier and to, you know, push back austerity.
I think, to be fair, from the moment that you have signed this deal, it will be very difficult. They don't allow very much space to be able to do things. And as you saw, if you saw the last few days, everything, even small things that we would like to do, the government would like to do. They are not releasing the money. So it goes with more and more measures that they are making sure that they tighten over whatever you try to do. So there are quite a lot of strikes. I think today or yesterday there was agriculture, a lot of people came in Athens and so on. And I think there will be more of that happening. So I think what the government is trying to do is trying to win small things, but they're small things. It's not something that it's going to necessarily reverse the situation. So the last thing I was reading about it had to do with the mortgages. So you try to protect a little bit those on the lower incomes to the degree that you can make a little bit of a difference there, but it's not reversing the measures. They're not stupid. I mean, they make sure that you are totally tied up. This is why I'm saying that if the conditions don't change in Europe, so you don't have more voices coming out against austerity, talking about Greece, different governments, that they are going to have a very different course of action than the ones we have so far, it's going to be very, very difficult. And I'm afraid that the situation will get worse and worse. And I really don't know where we will be in a year's time or 2 years' time. But although I would like to be optimistic, I don't necessarily feel that we're going to be in a good place. By the way, that's why, because of the series, I don't work for the Greek government. I'm just an activist. I'm not paid.
Anyone else?
Again, the question of how things might improve. Nick, I hope you might be able to tell us a bit more about the basis for the hope that you seem to have. You referred to political parties. I don't know what you have in mind. There's also the question of, is there some compulsion now for capital to behave the way it is? Like, you know, falling rate of profit or something that makes this the only thing that can happen now? Or is it just a political choice and Mike is right? And then related to that is, do you think Keynesianism is a way forward or not now? So that's three for Nick mostly, but not necessarily. And then Marina, I wondered if you could say a bit more about the DIY economy, do it yourself, you know, and whether you see any possibility for this to develop into something that could basically tell the European Union and the IMF to get stopped. And, you know, gets kind of Argentine situation where people are doing it themselves.
Yeah, I'm trying to be quick. I could probably write a dissertation and might not come to any conclusions. Look, I mean, I have obviously days when I'm very pessimistic about it as well. And, you know, you can't go to Greece and see some of the suffering that people are going through without being just very angry about it, you know. And angry about it because this isn't a natural catastrophe. This is, Joseph Stiglitz wrote an article where he describes this as one of the worst acts of economic terror in history. It's a man-made depression. I mean, all of this could have been avoided by a different set of policies. And that's the thing that makes you really angry about it. So what are the signs of hope? Well, first of all, you see, I think the projects you're talking about, people just trying to get together and do something to preserve a normal life and a decent life and preserve people from the worst of it, you're beginning to see things being set up which are actually outside of the market. And that's quite different, and it gives us the basis for something different. Now, I'm not saying that those are any more than small examples at the moment, but it gives us a basis for something different. And, you know, when you've been campaigning for a very long time against the rule of the market, against the idea the market can make everything better and is the answer to everything, you know, these things begin to change people's mentality. Obviously, doctors and health workers can't go on forever just not being paid for the work that they're doing, but nonetheless, there's a basis there for beginning to organise things in a slightly different way. And there's a concreteness to that that I think we didn't have, you know, 15 years ago. I got very involved in what we call the anti-globalization movement or the global justice movement, and that had some great victories and great successes, and we held the WTO up and we forced pharmaceutical companies to allow generic medicines in countries that meant massive amounts more people had AIDS medication, so on. So we had some great successes. But there were two problems with that movement, and one of them was I don't feel we had the concrete examples of people actually beginning to organize different ways of economy, if you like, outside of the market system. And you're beginning to see that now, not just in Greece, but in other places. You're beginning to see it here, you're beginning to see it in Spain as well. And the other thing that we never really achieved in the past in the anti-globalization movement, we never made any kind of impact on the political structure. So elite politics just continued as if the protest movement wasn't there, you know, or it tried to deride us and denigrate us, and we were terrorists sometimes, and we were a traveling anarchist circus, or whatever Blair called us at other times. But it didn't affect the party structure. I am astonished by how the party structure is breaking down now in the Western world. I mean, I was looking at something Clinton said in the election campaign the other day, where she said, you know, big business has captured our democracy and has got huge amounts of power over our society, and that's wrong. That's something you can't imagine Hillary Clinton saying 5 years ago, 10 years ago. It's extraordinary, actually, you know, for such a free trader to come out and say that, and say she doesn't believe in the big trade agreements like TTIP and TPP. Now, I don't trust her, but nonetheless, the fact that she's forced to say that by what's happening in the political debate in America is fascinating. The fact that we now have, hopefully, I think, in government in Portugal, you know, real radicals who believe in quite different ways of organizing and so on, being brought into government. The fact that we have in Spain very interesting things going on both in Catalonia and at a national level. The fact that we have a leader of the Labour Party bringing back debates into this country that we haven't seen for 30 or 40 years. I mean, that's something we never achieved 15 years ago. And it seems to me, you know, I'm not in any way saying it's going to be smooth sailing. It's going to be extremely difficult. But there are signs I've got of hope that I haven't seen before in my lifetime. And even Syriza, for all the disappointments that we faced, it's not over in Greece. This is not over. And the fact that we have a government there who, for all of their problems and faults, I think are genuinely interested in trying to serve Greece's people in the best way that they can, that's a move forward. And they can't do it on their own, and they need a lot of help. And that means us fighting here, and it also means us offering solidarity to them in the way Mike talked about, some of the ways Marina's talked about. But it's a very different basis for moving forward than we've had in the past. And I haven't really got, and I think there will be amazing victories along the way. So we were talking to people yesterday about setting up European-wide campaigns to try and prevent some of the privatizations that are going on in Greece now. We focused a lot on debt. Debt's an important mechanism, but I actually think it's far more for me to do with the privatizations and the deregulation now being pushed on Greek society, because it's been turned into this free market paradise, basically, where you can go and islands are being sold off and whatever else, you know. So I think we can wage really significant campaigns that, if they're coordinated at the European level, we can stop some of this happening. And look what stopping something happening achieved when it happened in Latin America 20 years ago, when people stopped the water system being privatized in Cochabamba in Bolivia. You know, when the Zapatistas, although they didn't stop it, tried to prevent NAFTA, a big free trade agreement like TTIP coming in. I think there are parallels to suggest, you know, it's not going to be easy, but these things can be a launch pad for something much greater. And so we can all get down, but I also think it's imperative on us to, you know, as Gramsci said, sustain some optimism of the will, even if our intellect is feeling a bit down sometimes, because it's really all there for the. The fight is still there. It's a long way from over, and some of these things are very exciting. And I won't answer the question about Keynes because I've gone on enough. But I would urge people to read Paul Mason's book, if you haven't read it yet, called Post-Capitalism. I don't agree with everything in it, but it's a phenomenal piece of work, I think, and gives a lot of insights into how we can begin to think of a society and an economy outside of the market, which employs different values, which is democratic, which employs public control, not in an old Soviet style, but in a much more democratic way. it for me is an incredibly hopeful piece of work.
I brought Keynes in twice specifically to compare what was standard technique, a standard economic way of working until basically the early 70s. And by the 80s, Keynes had been thrown out of the window. In fact, the only thing Gordon Brown ever did that was useful was after he'd allowed the banks to crash and bailed them out, he actually remembered Keynesian economics, which is why from the period 2008 to the 2010 election, the British economy started recovering because he was actually putting large amounts of money into the British economy. Of course, from 2010, it's just been downhill. Whether it would actually work today, I don't know. I'm not a Keynesian supporter. I was just trying to use it as a comparison of what could have been done. And I suspect that there's a lot of truth in the fact that the old system has broken now. And we are going to see changes, some of them horrendous. Some of them, I think Nick is quite right, there will be periods and events to give hope. But overall, I mean, one of the things, to give an example, 0 hours contracts that we have in this country now, right, are what we used to call casualisation. But in the old days, the dockers, the miners, they turn up at the docks at 6:30 in the morning, you stand there and you're picked or you're not picked, right? But you're with your own people, so you can still organise. But to have a cell phone, a mobile phone, and wait for somebody to send you a text at 6 o'clock in the morning, whether you're working that day or not, you've got very little opportunity to organise. And the truth is that, never mind the new trade union bill, we already have less rights than we had before the First World War. I mean, it's been taken away steadily over the last 30 years. And we're going to end up with the new trade union bill, it's going to be back to the toll puddle martyrs. So that to do anything as a union, right, it's going to be virtually impossible or illegal. And that is possibly where we're going to end up. And that is that people are going to have to combine illegally outside of the unions to take action locally over what is happening. And there have been some strikes in Britain over the last few months, which have taken exactly that. Right, nobody's had a ballot, they've just done it on the spot. And nobody's yet been taken to court for doing it, because the employers have actually been quite happy to get people to work. Because the idea that you have to have a ballot, the whole thing to do is to hit the governor when it hurts most. And you don't want to have to give them 6 weeks' notice and allow them to bring in scabs legally. So I've gone on a bit, but we've got a lot of challenges, shall we say.
The DIY economy, it's quite interesting, and also solidarity networks that they developed, and different ideas about, which some coming from Argentina, like take on the factories and so on. I've just tweeted, I don't know if you have Twitter. If you have Twitter, I'm at Prentoulis, but I send it to you and Global Justice, which is a film, which is interviews, it has English subtitles, interviews of people that they've been creating new communities and new projects and so on. So it may be quite interesting if you want to see how they operate. Of course, they are not totally new. It's cooperatives, it's things that we have in the past, but it's new is that there was a huge urgency that we didn't expect, and all this started to happen. But they are far from managing the whole society and the whole economy. They're experiments, we can learn from that and try to develop them further, but we are not there yet. Even if you have, and we have quite a few social clinics, they cannot manage the health system in Greece if it collapses. It's too little in the way it is. But it shows that people are there, they want to volunteer, they want to do a lot of things. These experiments, I think they are developing, and some of the ideas in there, they're ideas that we are talking here in Britain as well. For example, in relation to growth, is growth the correct way to discuss where we want economy to go. How much can it grow? Will it always grow forever? So we start talking about different ideas, like the growth, and what would that mean? So there are all these new discussions happening there. In terms of telling IMF and the rest to go and screw themselves effectively, which I would very much have liked to do, it's quite difficult, and it's quite difficult again because of the politics of the situation. We have to remember that also there are geopolitical games that they are playing there, and Greece is in a very difficult position. So while we are discussing this, we have the refugee crisis. So effectively there are another 4 million people waiting in Turkey. These people, their way in Europe is going to be through Greece. If, and they're using the Paris attacks in that purpose, persuade that we should block people and close the close different countries from that, you may have another 3 million people blocked in Greece with very little to live in a country which is totally destroyed by austerity. And then you have, you see, a bigger crisis. And all these things are interconnected. So I don't think there are solutions that they go only one way. It's not only the economy, it's also the politics of the whole situation. That's why I insist that we have to change the way we are looking at European Union and Europe as well. If this is the European Union and say we don't take any more refugees, everybody will be blocked in Turkey, in terrible situation, and in Greece, and in Italy, and in places like that. And then how do you deal with that? Again, we have volunteers, but it's far from enough to deal with thousands of hundreds of people. Yeah. But I tweeted the film to you.
I will retweet you.
Yeah, but I don't know if you have to put it somewhere because it's,
yeah, well, it's in the
sorry?
On the website.
Yeah, because it's in watch it first because you may not like.
Speaking of tweets and webs and movies and whatnot, I mean, what role do we see for the mass media, for journalism, with its embedded journalists now rather than independent war reporters, for example, and for surveillance of the World Wide Web, etc., etc., and these modes of communication that I must say younger people than me would be probably more confident with. I mean, funny enough, I'm just thinking about people like Murdoch and how the message is controlled and manipulated. You touched on the idea that the terrible massacre in Paris may now be blamed on, somehow distorted into blaming refugees because somebody might have sneaked in with them, and how these messages are arguably manipulating people. And I'm just looking behind you, sir, and there is a sign, it's an Orwellian type sign saying, do not turn off TV screen. I'm looking at that thinking, Christ, is that the future? And then I'm reassuring myself by thinking, we have turned off the TV, it's not on. And I'm listening to human beings talking, so maybe that's something. But seriously though, the mass media and communication, because it sounds increasingly as more people are being affected by austerity, how they communicate and get together, and how is it a coincidence that surveillance laws are being enacted now or pushed in order to crush possibly a means of organisation? I suppose what earlier on about the question was how are Greek journalists getting on putting their message across?
What happened with that national the TV station that they occupied?
We opened. So Greece has a very different media system than in Britain. And I know that you watch the BBC and I complain and everybody complains about how manipulative it is and how neoliberal, but if you see what is going on, it's terrible, it's terrible, it's unbelievable. There was never this idea that we have here, even if it's violated, there was this idea that there is there should be some distance between journalism and politics. They may not do that in effect, but if you ask journalists, they will always talk about that. In Greece, I was never there because it never developed in the way that it developed here in the 18th and 19th century, free journalism from the state and so on. So what happened in Greece is that because it was so obvious how they were trying, for example, to slack Syriza and say to people what to vote, even with the referendum. I mean, it was amazing how all the channels were coming out saying, no, we are Europeans and we should vote yes and things like that. I think people got fed up with them. This is how Syriza came about. And I think something similar, I think, happened with Corbyn here as well. I mean, they slack the guy so much and it becomes so ridiculous at certain points that people had enough. I mean, they went beyond a certain limit there, trying to keep objectivity. What Syriza did is that we do have our newspapers still, weekly and daily newspapers. There is a radio, but also what the previous government did is that they closed down the public service broadcaster, the equivalent of the BBC. Believe me, I wish it was as good as the BBC. And again, I know that there are all sorts of criticisms, but it was so bad anyway. But the idea was that it was the public service broadcaster, they closed it down, it was occupied, and still it was running and the radio station by volunteers. When Syriza got power, they reopened it. And so you have a channel which is in favor, let's say, or it may be a little bit critical to Syriza, but it's from the left, rather. There is a problem with mass media, but sometimes I think we over-exaggerate the impact they have because they have become so ridiculous that people don't buy that anymore. In terms of new media, I wish I was younger and I could tweet better and do all these things better, but it opened up possibilities for us or for the younger people. So we are thinking quite a lot on, for example, whenever I'm discussing with people the possibility of a cross-European campaign or a movement there. This is something that we have which could help us while it wouldn't be able to help us in the past. Did I answer the question?
Could I just add that one of the things that is happening is that the mass media, in one sense, is becoming condensed, but in another sense, it is actually breaking up. The figures for the actual sales of mass media papers are very low. I got a figure the other day for The Guardian. They're down to 160,000 copies.
The Guardian?
Yeah. There's been attempts to
but
have...
But this is the actual paper.
Yeah. But they have no paywall online. Yeah. But some of the paper media do have paywalls, and they find they don't work. Certainly, I can't imagine why anybody would have paid for the Sun, but they've taken down the paywall on that. And what has happened is that social media, especially Twitter, has, to a sense, been used politically. And people are finding that you can utilise social media for politics that are outside of the mainstream. Certainly, Occupy has worked quite well with social media. And it's up to people to find ways to get round the fact, you know, the mainstream media is not going to fairly report what is happening from the left, from the trade unions. It's going to lie, blatantly lie. You only have to look what happened over Iraq. And even now, most of the media cannot actually bring itself to say, oh, we were lied to over the whole thing. And you could practically say that every time we attempt regime change, we end up with things like Paris. You know, so there is some hope. And as far as the spying is concerned, I just want to... They are taking everything. Now, whether they're actually capable of dealing with it, but if they're not looking at my stuff, I get quite annoyed, really. And certainly, just to end, I've found that since I started a website, while you're not getting the numbers that mass media get, you do get quite a lot of people that will read what you're saying, will comment on it. And so it is part of a process that what we have opened up is the ability for more people to express their opinion than could be done 20, 30, 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. So there are some positives in it.
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
I was just mentioning, like the one happened with the 9/11. It's like all about the United States at the time. But now with what happened with Paris, and then they're saying there was actually a lot of criticism. I'm not sure, it may be in just my bubble, so to see, but I've joined a few right-wing little Englanders groups, and they are mentioning what happened in Beirut, Syria, Iraq, Nigeria. So it's like there was actually a whole, of course, discussions and arguments over the internet, on Facebook mainly. But then I found it fascinating that it's actually, it encompassed sort of the whole world, rather than saying, just we Paris, but then nothing else about all the other ones, and saying, but then when French started bombing Syria and people started asking, so which flag should I put in my profile now? Because they have started bombings. And then, new stuff is coming from videos from Syria about what's happening to those people there because of the bombings from Russia and France and all that sort of thing, which is actually quite sad. But I suppose it's a way of saying that it is actually, that the media is actually expanding, although maybe not as much as we would like it to be.
Can I add something? The problem I have sometimes is that because I was talking on mass media in Britain, and is that sometimes I'm afraid, however, that I live on my own bubble as well, and all my friends are on the left, and we forget that. So I think all the people I know, I'm related to, like follow on Twitter, they're on the left. All the people on Facebook that I know, they're on the left. And all the people that they say, oh, what you said is great, are on the left. And then I live in my own bubble in a way that you start thinking, and I felt that with Facebook. My Facebook is that everybody's on the left and we are about to have a revolution. That's the concept that comes out of there. We are almost ready, we're getting there. And this I find quite problematic as well, because I sometimes need to remind myself that there is some other people, not the right wing, but the middle, where I don't know how they listen to what I say or how they would react, and I don't know them and they don't tweet me or they wouldn't say anything on Facebook to me. And that's what I would like to think more. How some of the things that we say, which for us it may be common sense, but how do you communicate them further?
Okay, there's two examples I wanted to bring up that give me some, and this is such a key question, right? This comes up every time I speak about everything, the question of the media. So people are very conscious, I think, that it's a big problem. Two interesting examples. One was the Scottish independence referendum, when the people, especially the radicals who were pro-independence, they said, well, this doesn't represent us, the media that we're getting. It's so skewed against us. And it became such a problem that they said, we're going to set up our own media. And they now have The National, which is a daily newspaper, print newspaper. They have Bella Caledonia, which is a news website. They have Commonweal, which is a kind of campaign organization linked to news. And these things have more people looking at them than all of the mainstream Scottish media up to that point. So they transformed what people were reading through that referendum campaign. And an organisation like mine, I mean, we're similar to Commonweal in some ways, it's a great organisation, by the way, social justice organisation. The first people they took on when they got money was not campaigners as we would have taken on, it was journalists. They actually have journalists in their organisation reporting and providing analysis, providing information and communications, because there's an understanding of how important that is. And these organisations are just fantastic now, and they're creating an alternative news that's actually read by more people than the actual news. So I think this is something that it is important, and it's something that I think organisations like mine need to really think about. The second example, which is more from a social media perspective, is Spain.
I mean, whenever I meet activists in Spain who started off with the indignados, and now some of them went into Podemos, and some of them went into the anti-eviction campaign.
They're much better than the Greeks.
Oh,
much
my better. God. The way they use social media is phenomenal.
Why do you think I have Facebook? The comrades from Spain came to my house, and they set it up for me.
but again, they spend time doing workshops. I mean, because they said they were like us at the beginning, and they said we didn't know how to use it.
Yeah.
And they really, I mean, these guys are experts. And they have used social media to very seriously change the national debate. Very seriously change, you know, through little things that we think, oh, does that work? You know, the hashtags, the memes, the whatevers. So seriously change and transform public debates. And I think, again, that's something we need to look to. A lot of the organizers, you know, not all, but, you know, we have in our local groups around the country, we have people who are getting on in years, who are often a little bit skeptical and scared of these things. So we need to make people a lot more comfortable, I think. I mean, again, going back to Paul Mason's book, I mean, he says the thing that we have that previous generations didn't is information.
Mm.
And we're probably just at the beginning of recognizing what we can do with that and recognizing how we can use it. And I think it's going to be one of the big questions we face as campaigners and activists in the next 10 years.
Just as an aside, Paul Mason also makes the point that Marx had recognized that the information was key to it in a system, 150 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So that maybe he's more relevant than Keynes now.
Any other questions?
I just wondered if it's possible to sort of give a bit of perspective from Africa. You talked about Latin America, but just have a sense of how that can mesh, because nobody talks about that much.
Okay. I'll just start, because I lived in South Africa 8 years ago, 7 years ago, from 2000. So I was 8 years in South Africa post-apartheid. I went originally to advise one of the provincial governments on tourism, and ended up staying working with townships to try and get some tourist rands into township pockets, not all being snaffled up before they got anywhere near the township. Right. And it really was quite depressing, a lot of it. The government is totally corrupt. We talk about the Greek defence minister getting imprisoned and the Germans not getting imprisoned. In South Africa, the guy that somebody was convicted for bribing the current president over an arms deal. Surprise, surprise. There's never been an arms deal that isn't corrupt. And yet when Zuma went to court, he was acquitted of receiving the money. And Pile, who was sent to prison for 15 years, got the Saunders illness, was released because he was about to die, and he's still going strong.
I mean, I was more interested in a kind of austerity perspective. Yeah. I mean, you know, I know there are problems and there's corruption and whatever.
Well, what you've got is such an unequal society. Mm-hmm. And the deal which Mandela had to take, right, meant that they weren't allowed to do anything that would be considered progressive. They had to stay within the narrow confines. This was the deal that was offered to Mandela and the ANC, was take it or leave it, exactly the same as with Greece.
Sort of IMF tactics, yeah.
Well, yes, because somebody, an Afrikaner, that said to me the big mistake the ANC made was to keep the Afrikaners on to show them how to do it, because all they did was show them how to fiddle the whole operation of government, and it is totally corrupt. I mean, you sort of sit down and you're asked for money for anything by the politicians, by the officials. It is really quite depressing, because when I first went there, I thought this was wonderful, you know, having been involved in anti-apartheid. And there are still some wonderful people there, but it is very, very depressing.
It's an exciting time in some ways, though, isn't it? I mean, I agree, and I've seen some of that as well. But the civil society movements in South Africa are very inspiring sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
With the work they're involved in. I mean, the student stuff that's been happening
now
recently. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
The alternative unions that are being set up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think there's some interesting stuff, but outside, because I do also think South Africa is a bit of an exception as well.
Yeah.
And elsewhere in Africa, it's obviously a very varied story, but I think one of the reasons we don't speak more about Africa is because the structural adjustment there was so overwhelming. I mean, really did send huge parts of the continent back a very, very long way and destroyed huge parts of civil society. And I think for a lot of, I mean, it's obviously very, very generalized when you're talking about the whole continent, but, you know, there's a lot of young Africans who I don't even think are aware of their own history of struggle, which is why a lot of the time we try and talk about very inspiring examples, like the example of Thomas Sankara in Burkina Faso, you know, the president who came to power in one of the poorest countries in Africa, and within just a few years before he was assassinated, I mean, radically transformed that economy, radically transformed it. I mean, from zero literacy to 100% literacy, very, very progressive on gender issues. Amazing, and, you know, was assassinated for his efforts, and the guy who assassinated him has just been removed from power in Burkina Faso over the last year, which is hopeful. But I feel that a lot of civil society groups, if you want to call them that, movements, whatever you want to call them, activists, they're starting from a very, very low base. A very low base. And so they don't have a lot of the radical perspectives that groups in Latin America have got. I mean, there are some, obviously. But also, I mean, I think NGOs, charities have played a not a necessarily positive role in a lot of Africa as well. There are so many groups that are donor-dependent and therefore mimic what the donor wants to say, and that's become a way of life and a way of operating, and that's displaced movements from below, genuinely grassroots movements, and, you know, really shifted things. But, I mean, you can see, absolutely see signs of hope. So the work we're doing at the moment on food sovereignty, people fighting against agribusiness, which is, you know, Africa is the new frontier for agribusiness. There are groups in that we've got a couple of members of staff in Tanzania at the moment meeting with peasant and small farmer groups, same in Ghana, where they've held back really regressive laws that would allow Monsanto to come in and, you know, control and enforce its intellectual property regime, so farmers are forced, rather than sharing seeds at the end of a season for free, would be forced to buy seeds. You know, they've held that up in Ghana for years now. I mean, they were so desperate to get it through that they held a debate in the Ghanaian parliament on the day of the World Cup final because they thought no one would be watching, and they still managed to. So, I mean, there are positive signs. I think one of the... I mean, there's one newspaper I do rate, no one can afford it, and that's the Financial Times, because that does actually tell the truth about quite a lot of stuff, and you find out a lot of interesting stuff. But they have they concentrate a lot on Africa because they've got this narrative, it's a wonderful place to invest at the moment. But of course, a very unequal economic and financial model is being put into place there. That in some ways actually is not dissimilar to what we saw in the 1970s, where you've got huge amounts of money flowing in into primary commodities, especially highly financializing primary commodities. And you think, well, what's the result of that going to be? And Jubilee Debt Campaign's done some great work looking at, you know, is this a new debt crisis building up? So it's a really complex and difficult picture, where I would say that, you know, again, like if you look at Greece, there's a lot to be worried about. There are some very depressing things, but there are some signs, I think, of social movements and activists and campaigns who are quite inspiring. But it's certainly not at the level of Latin America.
And you think it was sort of beaten down by SAP, do you? That's why
I mean, again, not entirely, but I think it played a very, very crucial role. Of course, because for large parts of Africa, again, not all of it, but for large parts of Africa, I mean, just getting over the fact that, you know, 10 million young citizens were sold into slavery and sent, you know, I mean, just getting over that, where generations of people were just removed, it takes a very long time, and then colonialism with all its exploitation. So. But you feel that in the 50s and 60s, there was a very hopeful discourse in a lot of countries. A lot of people here, you know, liberation leaders and whatever, studying in London, went back and really began doing things in quite a different way. And that was absolutely defeated by structural adjustment. And even the history, I think, has been erased by structural adjustment. And some of what we have to do is remember some of that history and remember, you know, and again, I mean, I'm very critical actually of the role charities have played in this reproduction in our heads of the idea that Africa has always been a poor, starving continent where people can't do anything for themselves. And overcoming that legacy as well is
really important. We need to include it in our conversation, I suppose, is what I was saying.
You're right, you're absolutely right.
I mean, we really should, because we can have solidarity with that continent as well as our own.
And I've just been on a tour, a TTIP tour, talking about TTIP with someone from Canada, and with Yash Tandon, who is an economist from Uganda. I mean, he was a freedom fighter against Idi Amin, and he was short length of time a government minister in Uganda. And he advises now, he's getting on in years, but he advises African governments to how they can better resist the trade offensive that's going on in Africa. And he's been going around all over the country, so I'd be in trouble today that you had to bring it up and not me, and saying, I will join your fight against TTIP, but partly because that gives me the opportunity to say to you, don't forget about the same type of trade agreements that are being forced on Africa at the moment to continually liberalise. The EPAs, the Economic Partnership Agreement, sounds very nice. And we will be having a big focus at Global Justice Now in 3 weeks' time of the World Trade Organization, which will be happening in Kenya, and trying to prevent the World Trade Organization from taking a step forward towards further exploitation of Africa, not allowing them to have any control over their food resources, and introducing a whole load of new issues. So hopefully that will raise it up the agenda a little bit in terms of the trade campaign.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's sort of driving, I feel a bit guilty of driving things back a bit, but when Marina was telling us about the Greek situation and so on, I just wondered, are words like partial debt write-off part of the language here? You know, I've heard nothing like that this evening at all. Mm. Maybe I'm beginning to understand the plot, but... Do you have any comments?
Mm-hmm. About writing off the debt, you mean? Sorry,
yes,
partial. Yeah, of course. Yeah. This is the next big campaign, I think, and what the Greek government will push and what we will be campaigning for. But I'm not amazingly optimistic about what is going to happen. I see a lengthy extension of the payments and so on. That's probably what they will try
to do. Do you want to put a number on it?
No, I wouldn't like to do the number. But yes, of course, I think this is the big issue now. Because if there is a write-off, there is still a possibility that...
Yeah.
But I know what type of people they are. I don't think they will do.
But even the IMF has said the only way long-term
is... Yeah. The IMF has actually said that 120% of GDP is the highest level of debt that they can consider.
Mm.
Sustainable.
So essentially a third of the Greek debt would have to be written off. And I think the IMF, in that statement that came out after everything was signed, said that there'd have to be no payments for 10 or 15 years, and the period would have to be extended, I don't know by how many hundreds of years. But the reality is the debt is unsustainable, and it was also borrowed or taken. I mean, it should never have been lent. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you talk about bad lending, you can't think of anything much worse than that.
That wasn't my question.
No.
but the thing is that the game between the IMF and the European institutions now has changed, and I don't think they will take the IMF
advice.
Yeah. Mm. So although this is what it should happen, I don't think we will see something.
But long term, it has to happen. But I guess there's also a question for people who are campaigners who have been calling for this for quite a long time, and it looks less likely than it was, you know, 2 years ago probably. Where do you focus on? I mean, we keep saying it, but in terms of where you focus your energy, for me, I just ask the question now whether it's actually better to try and stop this privatisation or bit of deregulation happening whilst continuing to talk about the debt, but there seems less. I mean, where I agree with Marina, I think there seems less opportunity politically at the moment for directly challenging that, and more for maybe challenging other. Which is not to say we don't believe in it or don't think it has to happen, but what's the political opportunity for being able to make it happen?
Anyone else have any questions at all? Maybe one last question?
Not a question, I have a call out. And it's to do with debt in this country and particularly fuel poverty, which is for many people a massive debt that leads to having a prepayment meter installed. And then when you go to top up your meter, you end up having the money for the debt taken off before you even get any fuel. And that's just one of the reasons, along with energy policy, lack of use of renewables, government policy cutting, housing standards, uncontrollable landlords, welfare cuts, low wages, and the rest. One of the reasons why we're expecting an even higher number to be announced of deaths from fuel poverty last winter. It's usually around 10,000 people a year in this country. That's kind of a low estimate, but it's something of that order. And this year it's expected to go up to 15,000, which is the most for 15 years. And Fuel Poverty Action, which I'm with, has for the last 4 years had actions on the dates of the announcement of these deaths. One of our tactics is called a warm-up, and it's based on the principle that if you can't afford to heat your own home, you should be able to go into any public building and warm up there. And we've had warm-ups in shopping centres and town halls and the Royal Festival Hall, and Occupy London had a warm-up in a bank. This year we're having a warm-up in Parliament, and we're inviting people to come in on Wednesday morning when the statistics are announced. Tell their MP what they think of it. You have a right to go in. We're lobbying, quote, our MPs. We're going to have letters for people to take. Bring the name of your MP so you can get through the gate. And then we're going to warm up in the lobby of the House of Commons. And I've got flyers for it there. Please do look and, you know, look for it online. It's on our website, Fuel Poverty Action. And network it and do try to come because, among other things, we don't know what the security situation is going to be like now, and a lot of the people who are organizing this are actually pensioners. We're doing it with the Pensioners Action Group and the Greater London Pensioners Association, and other people are coming are asylum seekers, and you know, people are single mothers and disabled people. DPAC is involved, so it's people are fairly vulnerable, and we really need people who are going to be like sober and well behaved but ready to stand up for people as well, and make sure that everybody's safe. So I hope you'll be able to join us. There's flyers for it over there.
Okay, just before we wrap up, I know Michael's spoken a little bit in his talk about an idea he's got for a business. I was wondering how that idea is coming along, Mike.
I don't know whether it's really a business. It's certainly non-profit making. I don't think you have to work very hard to make it non-profit making. basically, I've talked with David, I've talked with Nick, and I want to talk with Marina, and I've also talked with people I know from the travel industry whose politics are very, very different to people here. And nobody has ever given me a serious reason why, you know, the market, to use the commercial term, is people that are already interested in it, and they will come from those that can afford to pay to go to Greece to do this. In terms of progress, we're speaking with the National Tourist Office of Greece, so a very, very depleted organisation, down to three people on the fifth floor of a not very nice office building. Speaking with there's only one Greek airline left, that's Aegean.
You have to go by train.
Well, you'd spend 3 days going there.
No, you wouldn't.
It's impossible now, actually, to go to Greece, unfortunately, by train. Yeah. They've cut it, which is the first thing. That's how austerity and climate go together, actually. They've privatised all the airports to make them more productive, and they've cut the link with Europe. It's terrible.
Have you looked at the Cuban brigades?
No.
You know, because there's a well-established organization, I don't know, QBC. We'll be aware of it anyway, but where people will go travel from here, go to Cuba, you spend a week in Cuba, you work alongside the locals, cotton cane, quote, getting in the road, and then you spend a week on the beach, basically. So you might want to have a look at...
There used to be, well, progressive tours still exist, but they're no longer, they used to do all the holidays behind the Iron Curtain.
Yeah.
And they still exist, and they're still doing mainly Eastern Europe. I suppose the principle is roughly the same. So far, I mean, the main thing we're doing at the moment is getting a license. That people are actually protected when they travel. So I would hope that later this year or the beginning of next year, we're going to be asking people like Global Justice if they can put something out to their members, you know, supporters. And it is, you know, like everything else, it will be basically the people that have the money and can afford and have the time to do this. But I just think it could be quite interesting, and so far I've had reason. I'd actually like somebody to say to me, this is fine, but have you thought of A, B and C, to force me to sort of see what could be wrong with it. And in fact, I must say, the idea of taking a train is great if you were going, leaving aside the minor details, because you could certainly take a train down to Brindisi or that,
yes,
and take the boat across.
Yeah.
But it's the time. And one of the things which is from the travel industry side, what has happened is that trains are now more expensive than flying. And you only have to look. Well, one of the reasons is there's no tax on aviation fuel.
Mm-hmm.
It was always part of the duty free.
People going on your trip would, one imagine, would be caring about the climate, and you would be making a very strong commitment if you said we're going by train.
Maybe we could offer an option of train, because it is a lot longer and a lot more expensive.
And people like leisurely journeys, they don't want to rush everywhere.
Sorry?
You don't always want to rush everywhere.
Yeah, no, train boat option. It also gets over a problem, actually, it gets over a problem of getting to Thessaloniki.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is no direct flight really into Thessaloniki.
There you are. Sold up.
And one of the other things is we wouldn't do anything in July and August, which is the high season when there are enough tourists there anyway, it's too hot, especially if you're in Athens, to want to go round. So the idea is to bring people in the lower season, the mid-season, to actually fill up beds that would be otherwise be empty.
Mm. Yeah,
watch this space then.
Mm.
Watch that space. Mm. Okay, well, I think we can come to the end of our time.
Yeah.
So let's thank the three speakers, Michael, Nick and Marina.
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming, and thank you.